Welcome to Monmouth Classics on ESPN. I'm Eddie Acapinti. Since the inception of football at Monmouth University in 1993, the cornerstones of the program have been consistency, hard work, and success. The six-time conference champions and two-time FCS playoff qualifiers won the 2019 Big South Championship outright and have an impressive roster of former players who have played in the NFL. Please join us now as we take a look back at one of the most memorable football games in Hawks history on this installment of Monmouth Classics.
As we head into the last week of the regular season and having already locked up the conference bid into the FCS playoffs, the question for Monmouth is what can the Hawks do for an encore? College football next on ESPN. Looking forward to this one, the last day of the regular season that started all the way back in the beginning of September with the czar of the playbook, Emory Hunt. I'm Matt Harmon. Emory, you look at this Monmouth team. It's been a dream season for the Hawks. They try and cap it off today with their 10th win of the year.
Yeah, they did a great job in getting over the hump of Kennesaw State. They beat that dragon. Then they slayed another dragon down there in Campbell, blowing them out 47-10. We saw a great offense, great defense. They put together a phenomenal performance, which got them the victory and now puts them on the cusp of the playoffs like you talked about.
And you think of it already knowing going into the day today that they don't have to worry about necessarily winning, but more playing for a potential home game, a little bit of pressure off this team.
And a little bit of also pride, because you want to finish out with a winning note. You also want to go into a game knowing that, hey, we played our best, and that carries the momentum into the playoffs. So they have to come out today against Hampton and play their best game to carry that into the postseason.
Pete Guerrero, a fantastic day last week against Campbell in that 47-10 win for the Hawks over the Camels. Let's take a look at our impact players today. We've got a premier quarterback matchup. I know you love that. You look at DeAndre Francois. You look at Kenji Bahar, maybe the best two quarterbacks in the Big South.
Absolutely. They do about the same things athletically. They both can get in and out of the pocket, make accurate passes downfield. They work touchdown to check down. Bahar does a great job of protecting the football a little bit more, but you love how each guy gets the football to many different targets out there in the passing game.
You look at their numbers, each with 24 touchdowns throwing during the course of the year. Kenji with a good day today would be up over that 3,000-yard mark. Francois, maybe a little bit more of a dual-threat guy. We'll be interested to see how that running game maybe plays an impact in this one today. Monmouth undefeated at home here at Kessler Stadium during the course of the 2019 season. They'll look for another one here today. We take a timeout. When we come back, we've got the opening kickoff for you. Monmouth and Hampton here on ESPN.
Of Big South, where winners are made.
It is a beautiful November day here, a mile off the Atlantic Ocean of the Jersey Shore. Hampton seeing if they can pull the upset. There's the second-year head coach, Robert Prunty. Last year, he took his team to a 7-3 mark, 5-6 so far this season. Matt Harmon, Emory Hunt, good to be back with you here. And as we look from Coach Prunty to Coach Kevin Callahan, who's still the only coach in Monmouth football history, interesting where these maybe two programs are going into the last day of the regular season.
You like how both guys are their university's guy, because you talk about Prunty, he played at Hampton, and we know Kevin Callahan did a great job in building this program. And like you said, he's the only head coach in program history. So it's good to see guys that are their representative of their university through and through. And that bodes well for their future. Let's say for Hampton, as in they're in their second year with Robert Prunty as a head guy at the helm.
And in this year, the Pirates' first season officially football-wise in the Big South. Monmouth will be in the all-blue uniforms today with the silver helmet. That is the senior kicker, Matt Mascara, set to kick off to either Ronald Bell or number 22, that being Darren Butts. Should be a good one for you. Monmouth already qualifying for the FCS playoffs based on their win last week down in Campbell. Hampton looking to even their record going into the offseason at 6-6. All things considered, weather spectacular here in late November. Monmouth hoping that tomorrow they will hear their name announced for a potential home game in the 2019 FCS playoffs. A spot this year at Kessler Stadium they have not lost all year long. Mascara, the high end-over-end kick. It will be Bell to decide to take a knee and come out for the touchback.
He'll be first and 10 Hampton at the 25-yard line.
We talked about him in the open. DeAndre Francois, the former Florida State Seminole, a fantastic high school career, Emory. He was one of the top quarterback recruits coming out of high school. Few years with Florida State, finishing up things now at Hampton.
Yeah, he was a great quarterback at Florida State. Took a beating there throughout the time. He was the QB from that offensive line. But when you look at when he's well protected, he can touch anywhere on the football field with that strong right arm.
He'll take the first snap here and look to play action. Roll right, throw right. It is incomplete, but a flag coming out right away. Jadakiss Bonds, the intended target. He was grabbed by the senior corner, Tamir Berry. Warren Gillis, our man in charge of things today. So just like that, one play and a first down. A little bit of a grab right there, you saw on the replay. Francois wanting to throw again. He's looking in Bond's direction, this time to the near side, and he overshoots him with Justin Terry, the coverage.
Back-to-back plays, they went to Jadakiss Bonds on the right side, then he brought him back over here on the near side of the field. They want to attack touchdown to check down on his secondary. And there's some opportunities for Hampton to hit big plays deep down the field on these corners.
Second down and 10.
The receiving core of Hampton, a good one. A lot of former FBS transfers mixed in. Second and 10. Francois, we know he's got a strong arm, looks in Bond's direction again. Third consecutive target for him. Makes the catch, gain there of about three.
I guess it's safe to say they want to go to their number one guy early in this ball game. 14 touchdowns on the season, and they're working this secondary, and I think they're setting things up to maybe run shy of McKenzie later on in this drive, but right out the gate, passing plays, all three went to Jadakiss Bonds.
Bonds, as Emory just said, 14 touchdown receptions on the season, 66 catches now on the year. Third and 7, Francois with pressure coming out of the backfield, has a target, catch is made by Butts, who will get a first down and more into Monmouth territory.
Excellent job right there by Butts, getting that football and making that move at the sticks to get the first down. And when you get a guy like Butts out there in space, he's their starting kickoff returner. You want to create those broken field opportunities for him. That was a play that was specifically designed for that. Great job by Butts.
McKenzie coming back in at the running back spot. There you see the Hampton offense. We will keep an eye on number one, Shy McKenzie.
The former Virginia Tech Hokie does a great job. Ran over 1,000 yards this season. First time since 2012 for Hampton.
First carry for him on the day on cue. Gets about half what's needed for another first down.
Yeah, McKenzie's been excellent for Hampton, man. You talk about a guy that had transferred in, finally started to get his sea legs underneath him with this program, and we saw him average 5.2 yards a carry, go over 1,000 yards, and put himself in position to be a pro prospect, as a lot of scouts are very intrigued by what he brings to the table.
2 minutes in to this opening quarter, McKenzie 5'11", 224. Second and 5, Francois looking deep. He wants it all, has Bonds, and that is a Hampton touchdown. Quite the start here for the Pirates, wanting to get Bonds involved. They do it a couple of times, capped it off with a long throw.
That's just excellent film study right there by Hampton, because they came in with a plan. They wanted to work touchdown to check down on this secondary, and they found Jadakiss Bonds deep down the field. They were trying to hit this play earlier in the drive, but they finally connected deep with a great throw by DeAndre Francois. Excellent start for the Hampton Pirates.
You can see that number, the 14 touchdowns. It's now 15. Tops in all of FCS football. High snap for the extra point. This one does get through from Evan Lomax, who is now 33 of 40 kicking extra points. This is exactly what Hampton needed to get this game up and going.
Yeah, just a great job. Wasn't anything fancy, just a straight nine route down the sideline. So it's going to be up to Tymir Barry and the rest of these corners to find the football and use that sideline as their friend. Barry kind of lost track of where the ball was, but a great throw by Francois right to the waiting arms of Bonds.
Bonds off to the good start. Hampton with the quick scoring drive. Five plays, 75 yards. Took 2 minutes and 14 seconds off the clock. Officially a 37-yard touchdown throw.
That's how you want to start if you're Hampton. You come into this ball game. They are not a bad football team. I know they're 5-6 right now in the season, but this offense averages 32.5 points a game. So they can move the football. They can also score, whether it's running, throwing. They do a great job on the perimeter. Their offensive line has been the biggest issue, and that's going to be something that we're going to have to watch the rest of this game.
Their lone win in Big South play coming at the beginning of November. They beat Presbyterian 40-17. They come off of a loss last week against Kennesaw State 50-7. High kick, but short. Returnable for Morales, who gets grabbed around the 26-yard line, and we will get a first look at this Monmouth offense. Hawks giving up the early scoring drive to the Pirates. And here comes Kenji Bahar, likely in line for the Offensive Player of the Year in the league.
Yeah, he's one of the best quarterbacks in the FCS, not just the Big South Conference, but the entire subdivision. Love how he has grown and matured in this position, and is one of the best players we've seen in college football.
Bahar will operate here with a four wide receiver set. On the ground for Guerrero, he's going nowhere, running right in to Andy Matthews.
And that's a lot of defensive tackle right there, 6'2", 296 up in the middle.
Oral Varsian, a kind of swing player listed as a defensive back. He's that hybrid type guy.
Yeah, he makes all their tackles. He's their leading tackler right there, and he can play shallow. He can play deep. He's great in coverage. Does a great job on all areas of defense.
71 tackles coming in at the top of the list for the Pirates. On the ground again for Guerrero, who doesn't need a whole lot to get himself up and going. He'll cross the plane of the 30-yard line. This balanced Monmouth attack, one guy they want to get involved, Terrence Green Jr.
He is their big play threat in the passing game. I love what I saw from him against Gardner Webb. Great job going downfield and going up high to get the football. We'll see how often they can get him involved in this game.
Green, 52 catches on the year. Lonnie Moore, 55 catches. That was the question for this Monmouth attack. How would they replace Reggie White Jr.? They've been able to do it across a lot of targets. Third down for Bahar in the flat. Catch is made by Guerrero. Watch out here into open space inside the 15-yard line and wrapped up around the 10.
Yeah, once you saw him get out there on the perimeter, you knew that linebacker wasn't going to catch him even with an angle. So you saw him get down that sideline and show that track speed. Guerrero is the top playmaker in this ball game. Just an outstanding read right there by Bahar, getting the football out in the flat, saw the mismatch with the linebacker, and Guerrero did the rest.
Guerrero over 300 yards of total offense a week ago. Bahar here flipping to the sideline. That catch is made by the Bahar's aforementioned Terrence Green Jr. Short gain down to about the 6-yard line.
Even that short pass was impressive because you saw him get his hands out in front of the defensive back and make that reception while he was trying to bat that ball out. Strong hands at the catch point.
Keep an eye at the Monmouth running back spot today. Fifth-year senior Devel Jones is out with an injury, so when Guerrero does need to be spelled like here, it's number 29, James Farah, who will come in. Little flip for Lonnie Moore. Weaves inside the five. Touchdown, Monmouth. Right down the field for the Hawks, and they answer the Hampton scoring drive with one of their own.
If you're Kenji Bahar, you love that play call because that counts as a touchdown pass for you. These easy touchdown passes the quarterbacks get nowadays, but nice play call inside the red zone. Normally when you're trying to play perimeter football, you want to do it out in space, but you get that call right there inside the 10-yard line, and it works out for you.
Here's the extra point for Matt Mascara. Right through the uprights and good. It looks as if we may be in for a little bit of a track meet today with Monmouth taking their opening possession, going right down the field, tying it at 7. The finish from Lonnie Moore, who gets into the end zone. this Monmouth class will go out as one of the better in the football history for this Hawk program, making the FCS playoffs in 2017, going back this year in 2019. And Emory, as you see, senior day before the start of today's game. It's always kind of, it's a little bittersweet, I guess. But for Monmouth, they're hoping today is not the last day they get to play on their home field.
Yeah, it's always bittersweet because you don't expect time to fly as fast as it does when you're playing college football. And it creeps up on you, whether you've been there 5 years or 4 years. It's just, it really gets overwhelming when you're out there. You remember all the practices, the coaching from the recruiting process. Everything just goes into senior day, and it just kind of gets overwhelming. You want to see guys get out there and perform. But for some, it could be the last time they're playing football ever.
Two quick scoring drives, one per side. Monmouth, their drive, 5 plays, 74 yards, took 2:06 off the clock. This is Ronald Bell at the 30-yard line. Flags all over the place. You know the penalty was picked up when you see 1, 2, 3, 4 yellow flags down on the field.
Yeah, the last ref didn't want to feel left out and threw his flag just now. But everyone saw the same play. It was an egregious block in the back where the guy tackled the Monmouth player to the ground.
All of the referees picking up the yellow flag and putting it at the same spot.
There are 2 fouls on the play.
Oh, there's two.
Both on the receiver team.
Illegal block in the back will be one. We lost the microphone there for just a second, and holding is the other. Should be able to pick it up pretty easy. There's the hold.
I think 80 did the hold and the block in the back.
Yeah, he got his money's worth there, right?
Make it count, man. If you don't get a flag, get all the flags.
That's Lorenzo Thompson, the redshirt senior wide receiver. Let's see what this Hampton offense does for a little bit of an encore. They went right down the field against Monmouth in their first possession.
Offensive line held up pretty well on that drive. Francois was well protected on every pass attempt.
He'll motion McKenzie to his right. Gets the snap. On the ground, McKenzie, who is a hard runner, bounces down to just shy of the 25-yard line.
And it's a brisk day out here, so it's cold, but there's not a lot of wind, so the passing game shouldn't be an issue. But if you want to talk about cold, just look at DeAndre Francois. He has a sweatshirt on and the hand warmer. He is cold out there today.
It's not that cold.
The last person I saw that was cold like that was Bob Hayes.
I mean, listen, when you're from Orlando,
true,
I guess today would be considered cold. Here in the Northeast, this is almost summer-like at this time of year. Francois looking. The catch is made by Alec Dana, who hauls it in. You know, we mentioned this wide receiving core to have a flag that was thrown. It's going to be charged to Hampton. Right guard Miles Ferrell gets called. You know, the receiving core, to finish the thought, you've got guys from all over the place. You've got transfers in from Cincinnati, from Purdue, from Wake Forest. This is really, in a way, an FBS-wide receiving core working with an FBS quarterback.
Exactly. You look at the offensive line, it's a bigger offensive line than you'd see at the FCS level. So, yeah, this is an FBS-type offense, which is why their offense averages about 32.5 points a game. And they're big on the perimeter. You're talking about guys that are 6'3", 6'4", 6'2". So they create some matchup problems out there in the passing game.
Butts in at the running back spot. A pistol look with a 4-wide receiver combination. Motioning out of the backfield. Might be a backwards pass, and if it wasn't, it didn't miss by a whole lot. It will go as an incompletion, and I see the Monmouth coaches right now looking and saying, well, that was a lateral, not a forward pass.
And coaches on Hampton's side is figuring, man, if Butts was about 5'11", he catches that football. He threw it over his head, the shorter running back. But you see right here, you look at where he's set up, and that ball, it was a forward pass because he was right in front of the 5-yard line. It kind of stayed parallel going out of bounds on the side. So good call by the officials.
Monmouth will bring an extra defensive back. They might look at this.
Francois threw it on about the 5.5, and the ball hit maybe about the 5.25. So technically, it could be a lateral, but it'd be a split in hairs. But they're taking a look at it, so.
3rd and 17 as it sits right now. It would be 3rd and about 26.
Yeah, the ball just got away from him. I mean, he had good fundamentals, good technique, and the ball just kind of sailed on him.
We talked about Francois being the former Florida State transfer. He was starter in 2016, 20 touchdowns, and a real solid, almost redshirt freshman year. Injured in 2017, and then in 2018, behind kind of a pretty injured, banged-up offensive line, struggled a little bit, and now here at Hampton. I don't know, Emery. I kind of feel like that's a backwards pass.
Yeah, it may have been just a hair behind where he threw it, which would be now 3rd and about 16 for Hampton. But to piggyback off your point about Francois,
that will cause Hampton to lose 7-8 yards and make it 3rd down here at about 25.
Yeah, so Francois has played well this year in Hampton, settled down, came to a new program, and started to look like the guy we saw in 2016. And that's impressive, which is why there have been a lot of NFL scouts heading down to Hampton to check him out, as well as Shia McKenzie. So Francois definitely has a future in pro ball. It's just about getting back to football, and that's what he's done so far this season with Hampton.
Two receivers either direction, 3rd and extremely long for Hampton. 9 minutes to go in the opening quarter. Out of the shotgun. Pressure coming. Safe throw over the middle. Bonds juggling it, makes the catch, and then gets wrapped up around what would have been the original line of scrimmage before that instant replay. At the 17-yard line, the Pirates will be forced to punt.
Interesting, had he not bobbled that football, I don't think he would have gotten as many yards as he did once he was able to bobble it and haul it in, because it kind of redirected him to get right back upfield. So he made this an easier punt for the special teams unit. But good stop by Monmouth's defense, forcing that 3-and-out on his drive after giving up a touchdown on the first one.
Should get pretty good field position here. Eddie Morales lingering around his own 45-yard line. Aroha. Short punt. It will take a little bit of a Monmouth roll backwards. Those are always dangerous because you never know who it's going to hit. But it will be Hawk football. They will take it over in Hampton territory at the 40-yard line.
Yeah, they're set up with great field position. That was a low punt right there. You're going to see right here on a replay. And credit Monmouth special teams unit for not getting touched by the football, but they couldn't really see it. So you're set up here on the plus 40-yard line if you're at Monmouth, with a great opportunity to put more points up on the board.
Dangerous proposition with Kenji Bahar, a short field to work with. 1st and 10, 8:02 remaining. Second time today that Monmouth has it. Second time today they used that little flip play to Lonnie Moore. Hampton, much better defensive job here, as it will only get back to the line of scrimmage.
Perimeter speed is one of the strengths of this Hampton defense. And again, they're good versus the run, only giving up 4.1 yards a carry. So again, they're not a bad football team. What has hurt them this year have been penalties and turnovers. And those are two things that really kill you as a football team.
Good stop in the open field by Tyler Frazier. Loss of 1, 2nd and 11. Bahar pressure going backwards. Gets grabbed down, loses the football, and I think Monmouth was able to get it back. They were. That's the right tackle, Justin Zuba.
What a great job of getting pressure right there on the outside by Hampton. Bahar had nowhere to go to. He was trying to spin out of that, but spun right into the Hampton Pirates. And you see great pressure on the right side. Just continue to pressure the pocket. That's big number 97 once again. Sturdivant, the graduate, 6'1", 304, just collapsing that pocket. Is 3rd and I-95 for Monmouth.
And not many in the playbook here for 3rd and as many as it is for the Hawks. They'll put it on the ground with Guerrero. He'll dance on the far sideline, keep his legs moving, get close to midfield.
Well, that's a big stop right there by Hampton. If there was any question about Monmouth's offense, you could look at the offensive line, and right now you have to like what you're seeing from that Pirates defensive front, just getting pressure, creating a little bit of discomfort in the pocket for Bihar.
Obviously, that second down sack and subsequent fumble making Monmouth have it to punt it away here after starting in plus territory. Pressure coming on Ryan Kost, who puts one inside the five and gets grabbed and downed by the Monmouth special teams unit. 5:52 to go. Hampton's turn. Pirates and the Hawks tied at seven.
The NCAA Division I FCS, every down, every day.
Second and 10 coming here for Hampton, who yet again is pinned inside their own five-yard line. Came back a little quick from break. Francois will get this snap inside his own end zone. On the ground for McKenzie. Can't get a whole lot moving. And he gets back to the line of scrimmage. A Monmouth defense, Emery, that gives up only 117 yards per game on the ground. They've been pretty good, pretty stout all season long in that department.
Yeah, and this jives with what you're not going to see from Hampton. They're not a good running football team. They've had big runs in the run game, but their running ability is only averaging about 4.5 yards a carry. So it's going to have to be out on a perimeter for Hampton offensively, because you're right, Monmouth's defense does a great job versus the run.
Monmouth will bring in an extra defensive back. Nickel package here and a trips formation for Francois. Here comes pressure. He eludes the rush, will tuck it and run, head to the sideline with no opportunity with Daquan Grimes lurking in on him. And yet again, Hampton will have to punt.
It's a great job by the back end of Monmouth, not falling for the scramble drill when Francois gets outside the pocket. Guys continue to run with their guy deep. He was trying to catch Jadakiss Bonds coming back across the field, but he had double coverage. The Monmouth flow was able to push him toward the sideline and get him out of bounds, enforcing his punt.
Ivan Aroha on to punt. Last time he had a pretty short effort. This time he's got a step in between him and the back of the end zone. Morales waiting at the 35. Pressure coming. Gets off another one of those low kicks. Morales will get away and then decide to fall on it to stop any momentum. Hawks will get another opportunity inside Hampton territory. 4:08 remaining here in the opening quarter. Mama's 7, Hampton 7.
More than 4,000 student athletes, one attitude. We are the Big South, where winners are made.
This Big South Network broadcast is brought to you in part by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com today. And by Marriott, the official hotel partner of the Big South. And also by Sunbelt Rentals. We have equipment for that. Back with the czar of the playbook, Emery Hunt. I'm Matt Harmon, enjoying this regular season finale in Big South football action. Monmouth and Hampton have treated us to an entertaining first quarter, tied at 7. Hawks come back on second consecutive possession. They will start in Hampton territory. Bihar over the middle has Lonnie Moore. He'll slide forward over the 30, get down to the 27.
It's a great read by Bihar, because they're playing two men on the outside. So those corners were locked up one-on-one with those receivers. The soft coverage was in the slot, where he was able to find his Lonnie Moore over the middle of the field.
Quickly back before the change could even get set. Moore will snap it and get wrapped up around the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, you're going to see right there on the previous play, just a great job off the zone read fake finding more over the middle of the field. He had the softer coverage. He was running against zone. Everyone else on the outside had tight man. So good read by Bahar. Great catch by Moore.
Second and 10. Guerrero in the backfield. Quick pass to the outside. Moore catches it in space and runs forward through a tackle. Close, and I think just enough for a first down.
Moore seems to be the go-to guy so far in this ball game, in the passing game, because you look at how quickly he is once he gets that football in his hands. He's shifty enough to make a guy miss in space, and we know he has the speed to take it to the house.
Monmouth looking to the sideline here. We're inside of 3 minutes in this first quarter. Tight end right. Scott in as the H-back. Bahar looking, had Parham, and then deflected away at the last second. Great play in space by Caleb Brown.
Sometimes great plays are nullified by greater plays, and I thought that was a greater play right there by Caleb Brown. 6'1", 197, needing all of that height and that length to bat that ball away because he was going to the tight end. Bahar was just a great job in getting enough of that football to bat it away from Quentin Parham, the tight end.
Sets up second and 10 for Monmouth. Good look at Caleb Brown for the Pirates. Bahar with a trips off to the left. Throw in space. Moore catches it again. Dropped at the 10-yard line. Coming up to make the stop, Jave Brown, the former Coastal Carolina Chanticleer.
So good job by Bahar getting the hands on that football. It was a low snap, and he had to find a way to get the football enough to get it out to Moore. And Moore, again, just doing a lot of damage on these short routes where he's just catching and running up the field. So at some point, Hampton will have to adjust, and they'll probably find someone else to try to target. But right now, Moore seems to be the guy for Monmouth.
Fifth catch of the day for Lonnie Moore. Bahar so far, 7 of 8. Now over 100 yards. Guerrero to motion out of the backfield. Quick throw, and the catch is made. Zach Treadway, who's had himself a fantastic year for this Monmouth team. That's his 30th catch. He was a guy that was not in the starting lineup at the beginning of the season with an injury to Joey Aldarelli. Treadway stepping in and has performed very well.
Placement matters every time you throw the football, and you saw the corner blitz come, which prompted Bahar to throw it out there quickly, but he had to throw it outside because the guy was creeping up to try to pick that ball off. Great understanding of where you are on the field by Bahar.
First and goal for Monmouth from the Hampton 6. Bit of a busted play between Bahar and Guerrero. Maybe lost a half a yard.
Credit this Pirate defense for making this about Kenzie Bahar and not also about Pete Guerrero. They honed in on him and have come into this game with the plan to stop the run. They only give up 4.1 yards a carry to opposing running backs, so they're pretty stout along their front four.
Guerrero to stay in. Monmouth with a different look. Parham and Scott both in. Now both on the left side. In space, Guerrero catches it. Shorts out of the field. Dances inside the five. Touchdown. That is what Pete Guerrero does so well. Does not need a whole lot of room to operate.
That was a great job by Pete Guerrero. That was all him, making guys miss in space. And because of his speed, he really challenges you as a defender when you're having to take those angles. You have to be correct every time. But even though sometimes you're going to do a great job and sometimes you're going to get done like you just did right there, it's a great play by Pete Guerrero.
Monmouth able to capitalize on the short field. 8 plays, 46 yards, took 3:37 off the clock. Mascara, the extra point, makes it a 7-point spread.
That's a great job by Pete Guerrero, just outstanding play in space. And when you have a guy that's a great threat on both ends of offense, you're going to find your way to Peter, and he did right there with a touchdown.
Only so many times, if you're Hampton defensively, can you kind of live with danger of giving Monmouth the good field position. Last two drives for the Hawks, starting on the plus out of the 50-yard line. There's the big play chain that's become a little bit of a symbol here. You know, interesting, I think last weekend, they might have had to order a new emblem down at the bottom. I think last weekend, somehow it was broken. So it's become a little bit of a thing here in Monmouth. So I'm sure they didn't want to go a game without it, but it is out in full display. And from what I know about it, I think that is the brainchild of Kenji Bahar.
Yeah, and it was during the Gardner-Webb game where we first saw the big play chain, unbeknownst to Coach, who didn't know the chain existed until they started scoring touchdowns and saw the chain on the sideline. So great job by Bahar keeping it under wraps until it was game time.
And it's a good thing that it worked against Gardner-Webb, or I can assure you it would never appear again. Pooch kick set up here, fielded by Hampton, who almost got themselves in a good spot. That's Lorenzo Thompson in a place where most would call for a fair catch. He decided to take it and go a little bit.
That's a heads-up play by Lorenzo Thompson. The wherewithal to not only field that kickoff, but advance it past the 50-yard line. Now you set up Hampton inside the 50 with a good chance to go in and get points on this drive before the quarter ends. But you see right there, just a heads-up play. Mama's trying to surprise Hampton on special teams. There, Johnny on the spot to make a play.
So now it's the Pirates who have good field position. They take it at the Monmouth 48. Francois so far on the day, 4 of 6, and the touchdown. On the ground, it's McKenzie. He's a tough one to tackle. He'll pick up about 8 and be close to a first down.
Very entertaining first quarter between these two teams. And defensively, I've been impressed with the adjustments Monmouth has made in the secondary.
Francois looking up at the clock. He will be content to let the first quarter come to a close. Monmouth will take a 14-7 advantage into the second quarter.
With that 7-point, that last touchdown being done right there by Pete Guerrero on the sideline, just making guys miss in space, and we'll be back after this.
For when traveling is a good thing, find out how much you could save on car insurance with a fast, free quote from Geico at geico.com. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. We start the second quarter here from the Jersey Shore with Emery Hunt. I'm Matt Harmon. Hope you're enjoying our continuing coverage of Big South football here. It is number 12 Monmouth leading Hampton by a score of 14-7.
And they've earned that 12th ranking. I'm a voter in the FCS stats poll, and Monmouth has played really good football on both sides of the ball and well-deserving of that 12th ranking.
Here is Francois on second and short. Gives it to McKenzie, who runs right in to perhaps the biggest man defensively for Monmouth. That's Adam Kakar, 6'3", 330.
Yeah, it looked as though he ran into the back of his lineman, too. Big number 77, Keldrick Wilson, 6'6", 296. So, yeah, that between him and that mama's defense, it's going to bounce you back a little bit.
That's about 700 pounds that you just ran into. Don't think that's going to go on the positive side for McKenzie too often. Third down here. That's Bonds over the middle. Good defensive play by Justin Terry. You know, you think of the two Monmouth corners, Tymir Berry probably a little bit more talked about in his career. I think Terry has had just as good, if not maybe in some cases, a better year.
Yeah, he's done a great job overcoming a lot of adversity on the perimeter. And on that replay, you saw, you want to see your receiver help out your quarterback. I thought Francois put that ball where it needed to be, but you saw Jadakiss Bonds kind of stop on the route and allow the cornerback back into the play. But you're right. He has been playing very well out there at corner this year.
Low snap picked up by Aroha. Morales will let it bounce. It gets touched by Hampton and downed at the 1 yard line. Fantastic job getting down the field by the Pirates. Rashad Herriot, the one who comes up with it at the end. Not much that you can do if you're Eddie Morales in that particular situation.
It's probably the best punt we've seen so far by Hampton, and they were rewarded by it being down inside the five-yard line. It's a great job by the special teams, by the coverage units.
The initial touch by number 31, that's Curtis Holmes Jr., the 5'10 transfer from Montana. That state is buzzing today. The battle of the wild between the University of Montana and MSU. Second, check it, first and 10 from the 3-yard line is where they mark it. Movement up front. Believe it will be encroachment on Hampton.
Offside. Defense, number 92. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Roman Bond getting a little bit of an early start.
Nice hard cadence right there by Bahar, forcing those guys to jump off sides. And the wind is starting to pick up here, and it's in the face of the Monmouth offense. So we'll see if that changes the play calling on this drive.
First and 5. Bahar throws. It's Moore again to make the catch. Gets a first down. Steps out around the 19-yard line. Sixth catch of the first half for Lonnie Moore.
And they're going tempo, getting right over the ball right away.
Bahar will take his time here. Plenty of time on the play clock. Guerrero on the ground. This is dangerous. It's a foot race now with Guerrero to the 40. 35-30. 25-20, they call him the Jet, and he has landed in the end zone.
Outstanding display of speed. He pulled away from Caleb Brown, the defensive back, who was not only back there at safety, but also had an angle, and he could not catch Pete Guerrero as he was streaking to the end zone.
81-yard touchdown run for Guerrero, the reigning Big South Offensive Player of the Week. He's pretty much done that all year long.
There was no one in the middle of the field for Hampton's defense, and Guerrero broke that second wave and just outran everyone to the goal line.
Mosquera's extra point tacked up and in. The chain is back out, and it's Guerrero to wear it again.
Yeah, you're going to see right there, just right down Main Street, breaking through that first wave, and he's off to the races, and we are off. The commercial break.
For the new language of travel.
Bonvoy.
Marriott Bonvoy. 30 hotel brands, endless experiences, rewards reimagined.
The story of Pete Guerrero, one of the best over the course of the last couple of years in FCS football, came to Monmouth as a track and field guy, then figured out, you know what, I kind of miss what I used to do in Lyndhurst, New Jersey, get myself back on the gridiron. And right now, he continues to lead all of FCS football with that last run over now 1,500 yards.
If he's not a Peyton Award finalist, I would be highly upset, because you're approaching 1,600 yards rushing in an era where everyone loves to pass the football and doing it impressively, where you're getting yards in chunks. He's just a tremendous talent.
Quite the balanced offense for Monmouth between Bahar and Guerrero. Short kick for Mosquera into the wind. Coming up to field it, Bell at the 15-yard line. 25-30, 35, and gets out close to the 40-yard line, where it's now DeAndre Francois' turn to see if he can get this Hampton offense back up and going.
You look at the first drive of the game for Hampton, they marched right down the field with the big passing plays, and every other drive, they wasn't able to generate any level of consistency. They tried to run the football. It hasn't been as successful. Expect them to get back to that passing game, trying to find good matchups for Jadakiss Bonds and these other tall receivers out there on the perimeter.
Bonds will be the guy who will operate in the near part of your picture as one of two wide receivers. He does have 3 catches on the day, but all of that coming in the opening drive. Francois throwing, looking, That is deflected away. Good defensive play by the third corner for Monmouth. That is Morales.
You saw a little bit of pressure there coming from big number 90, Kyle Mullen, the transfer from Yale. Just getting that good push up there and kind of clogged up that window a bit for Francois, who still made a nice throw out and down the sideline, but just a tougher throw to make when you have pressure in your face.
Second and 10. Ball at the Hampton 38. This is McKenzie, who's got some room to work with. He'll get stood up right at the first down yard line by Anthony Budd, who will come up and make the open field tackle. But it is a first down, the best run of the day for Shy McKenzie.
Yeah, he was waiting for Keyron Catlett to make a block out there on the perimeter, trying to read his block. But just a great job right there by McKenzie getting the first down. And you just want to see Hampton stack positive plays on top of one another like they did on that opening series.
Francois, the snap, play action, pressure coming, hit as he releases the football, then deflected away by Powell. That was number 50, Daquan Grimes, who had 18 tackles last week against Campbell, pretty close to getting a sack.
It's a lot to unpack on that play. You had pressure coming in the pocket, then you had a linebacker that kind of got lost in space but found his way, tried to get his hand on the football, and a drop by Alec Dana. Right there, Dana on the back end of that play. So a lot was going on. It looked as though it was going to be intercepted, but then it should have been caught by Alec Dana right there in the secondary. So interesting play right there. You had a lot of chaos going over the middle of the field, and it fell incomplete.
Dana off, a little shaken up after the play. It's McKenzie again. Pops down to about the 44-yard line. Really like, Emery, how McKenzie runs the football. We talk about him being a transfer from Virginia Tech, so you know he's got the skill. He's a good between the tackles type guy.
Yeah, I was about to say something along that lines because you see a bigger back with very good footwork, and he was able to pick and slide his way through the line of scrimmage and pick up positive yards. So he's starting to get into a nice rhythm here running the football for Hampton.
7-yard pickup, up now to 34 yards on the day. On 7 carries. Francois, the shotgun. Zone read. He calls his own number. Slides forward close to the 40. That's going to be a Hampton first down.
What's interesting is that I was wondering when he was going to pull a football in that zone read because there have been a couple of instances where he had a lot of green grass out there outside the hash. He finally pulled the football and was able to pick up a first down.
A very interesting day on the final day of the regular season. Teams trying to figure out where they will be come selection Sunday tomorrow. A lot of teams on the bubble in another competitive field at the FCS ranks as McKenzie gets forward for about 3. It's a little nervy for all these teams from East Coast to West Coast, North to South. Everybody trying to think, have I done enough if you're not one of those teams like Monmouth that's already gotten an automatic bid?
Exactly. You're one of those bubble teams. You look at Southern Illinois. You're talking about one of the 3 teams out the OVC, UT Martin. Those teams are sitting here wondering, should we win big or should we just get the win and hope that our resume speaks for itself? So a lot of guys are sitting on the edge of their seats here the last week of the regular season.
Francois throwing, looking to the end zone. Had butts down the field. That was Hampton doing a good job. They isolated the middle linebacker, Daquan Grimes, who had to go over in coverage, was there step for step, but the ball just overthrown.
I was about to say, you got to give Daquan Grimes some credit. I mean, you're running step for step deep down the field with a speedy back who's there starting kickoff returner in Butts, and he was right there lockstepping and sort of forced him to go, along with the football, but sort of forced him to go toward the sideline to where that fell incomplete.
Third down at 7, maybe 4 down territory here for Hampton if they need it. Pirates trailing by 14. Shotgun Francois. Double clutch throw, and then the ball dropped by Ronald Bell across the middle.
Yeah, that was a high throw right there by Francois. That was a miss. He had the slow crosser coming over the middle of the field and would have given him a chance to pick up that first down had he hit him accurately right in that second window, which is across the guard and the tackle.
So after getting nothing in terms of yards, Hampton will elect to punt it away.
It's territory for fake, if you ask me.
Roja knuckles it up. Morales will call for and make a fair catch down around the 5-yard line, where Monmouth will get it towards the 10-minute mark here in the second quarter. Monmouth, the 21-7 advantage. Monmouth coming back on offensively with the highest ranking in program history. Number 12 right now in the nation for this Hawk team. 12 in one poll, 15 in the other. It's just been that good of a year, Emery, for this Monmouth team offensively, defensively. You look at what they've been able to do. And I would think come tomorrow, assuming that they get a win today, they would be in that conversation for not just a home game, but a potential bye in the first round.
I agree. You look at how they dominated Kennesaw State at the time, was ranked in the top 10. That played big in the eyes of the committee.
Bahar looking over the top, wanting to get Terrence Green involved. Good coverage down the field by Donald Smith.
That was a big play opportunity that was missed by Bahar. Usually he puts that ball out in front, but again, they're throwing into the wind, so you don't know how much that affected this throw. But good protection, good route. That actually was a drop by Terrence Green, hit him right in the hands.
Second and 10 from the 5-yard line. Guerrero in dangerous territory. Picks up about 4. Stopped just shy of the 10.
It's 3rd and 5 right here, 3rd and 6. I would expect Hampton to be in a tight man look to try to force a quick, short throw. Therefore, they'll be in position to rally up, make a tackle, and get off the field. So we'll see what they call here offensively to supersede that. You may see some sort of situation where you want to get the back out on a perimeter one-on-one with a backer. So some options here for Mama.
Guerrero checking out. Farah coming in. 4 wide receivers for Bahar to work with as well. Little circle pattern. Moore makes the catch and will get the Hawks a first down.
It's a great play call right there by Monmouth, because again, you had the outside guy running a slant, inside guy running a little swing route. Some may call it a pick play, but the offensive coaches for Monmouth will call that good play call.
And a first down out to the 23-yard line. Bahar quickly back to work, looking for Moore and just missing the connection. Here is that last play.
It's a great job, and you want the receiver running the slant to do exactly that. Stop in between two defenders. Don't touch him, otherwise it would have been a penalty and a pick play. But it's a great job by Lonnie Moore, making himself known once again in this passing game. And the play we just saw was a missed shot play by Mama, try to get the influence to go toward that short, quick pass and try to sneak someone down the sideline. Just couldn't connect.
Moore's got 7 catches on the day. Bahar this time has to move to his right. He'll elect to tuck it and run, tiptoe the Hampton sideline, and get pretty good yardage, 7, maybe 8 yards.
You see big number 97, Sturdivant for Hampton, standing right back at the 5 yards, the 15-yard line, saying, hey, bring all of that back.
Offense, number 69, 10-yard penalty, second down.
Justin Zuba who gets called for the hold. Zuba, the tallest of this offensive line for Monmouth, 6'8", 290 pounds, junior from nearby Brick, New Jersey.
If a taller offensive lineman, you always worry about pad level, and these shorter defensive tackles for Hampton are at a natural leverage position where they're getting underneath his pads, and it's tough to really not get a hold on those guys.
Second and about 20. Guerrero busting off another one. This time he'll get just the first down, dragged down by Christian Angulo. Every time he touches the ball, you're waiting for Pete Guerrero to just break off a big run.
That's the mark of a true game breaker when every play has a chance to go the distance. Pete Guerrero is phenomenal. Again, he's going to cross the 1,600-yard mark this season. And the way he's running the football, we may even see him go over 1,700 by the time it's all said and done.
33-yard pickup there. Guerrero's day so far. Only 7 carries, a buck 36. He's averaging 19 yards per carry. Comes out for this first down call. On the ground, it's James Farah. Fighting for a couple extra yards. We'll pick up 2.
You see right here on the replay, Guerrero just took his time, let the block set up, and just exploded through the hole. And had he not got tripped up right there, he probably would have scored once again. But just an excellent display of running by their outstanding junior tailback.
Yeah, and that replay, too, you saw good work from that offensive line for Monmouth. As good as Guerrero is, he's not getting it done without the work of the big guys up front. Fade pattern to the sideline. That is hauled in and caught by Terrence Green.
That was a pass that he dropped earlier in this series, and he was able to catch that football over Angulo, who lost track of it. And Angulo is a 6'2", 190-pound corner. So Green really using his body. He's about 5'11", going up and making that play.
Farah staying in here for this series for Monmouth at the running back spot. Without Devell Jones today, Monmouth trying to figure out ways to spell Guerrero when they can. Certainly will need him fresh come playoff time. With the play clock winding down, Monmouth will use a timeout.
Monmouth, 30 seconds.
First one taken by the Hawks today, 6:36 remaining. Second quarter, take a timeout here. Come back, we'll talk about what this Monmouth team has been able to do all day offensively. He's hiding in there somewhere. The head coach for Monmouth, Kevin Callahan, walking with his back towards us. He must know that we've got him on camera. He's been doing it for 27 years. He looks for his 162nd win of his coaching career here today. Here's that last throw, the big play. Terrence Green Jr., who, Emery, you wanted to talk about as we looked at that starting lineup for Monmouth. Between him and Lonnie Moore, such balance in this Monmouth offense.
And they're winning in different ways. Moore wins short and underneath with his quickness. Green is able to win deep down the field with his speed and ability to track the football.
Second catch of the day for Green. Moore's got 7 so far in the day as Bahar spreading it around. Got a flag coming out just as the ball was set to be snapped.
Ball start. Offense. Number 69. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Second penalty in the series on Justin Zuba.
And they were going for the touchdown on that play as well. They were trying to take that deep shot to Green down the sideline, who got a tremendous jump on a corner. We'll see if they come back to that here on first and 15.
Yeah, you knew Bahar thought he had it because he started hopping over to the sideline. Green to the right, trips to the left. He'll go down the seam. The talented tight end, Quentin Parham, into the end zone for a score.
What a great throw right there by KJ Bahar, just right down the middle, down that seam. Parham is a 6'4", 6'5", tight end. He's built like a receiver at 215 pounds, but he had leverage on that defensive back, got down the middle of that defense, and Bahar, with a nice slow fake to the outside, found him right down the middle for a score.
Barham's got 6 catches on the year. 3 of them have been for touchdowns.
Efficient.
Mascara for the extra point to make it a full 21-point spread. That is tacked up and in. We've been saying the theme for this Monmouth offense, a variety of ways to beat you. This is the third tight end, Quinton Parham, getting into the end zone.
And you just saw right there a subtle fake by Kenji Bahar and a subtle look to the left, which allowed Parham to get down the seam unaccosted, and he found him for six. And he puts on that big play chain right there on the sideline.
Listen, you're going to go down at the end of the game with some post-game interview stuff. I want you to get your hands on that chain. Maybe you can wear that when we do some post-game stuff.
You know, it kind of matches with the sports coat I'm wearing today. So you're right. It may be a good look for the camera. You might have to make that happen. I wonder who was charged to go and get a new big play chain. Because to have one get lost, number one, and then to go back and get a new one made, that takes a lot of effort.
Well, listen, when it works, you got to make sure it sticks around. Hampton, who had a 7-0 advantage, has now yielded 28 straight to Monmouth. Somewhat similar to when these teams played last year. Hampton went up 14-0, wound up losing that game 56-28. End-over-end kick fielded by Bell inside the 15. Runs through one tackle and then gets dropped around the 21. Giving chase down the field, Dante Kiet, the defensive back. Player slow to get up is Justin Dingle, the freshman linebacker for Hampton.
Hampton got off to a great start in this ball game, 7-0 lead, attacking deep down the field. And after that, it really hasn't been much offensively, and their defense has started to give up a lot in the passing game. So they're going to have to find some way to have some success. Essentially, what you want to do if you're Hampton, you have 6 minutes and 21 seconds left in this half. You want to take up at least 4 minutes of this clock to try to find ways to get points, whether that's 3 or 7, but they have to come away with points on this drive. Otherwise, it can continue to get out of hand going into the second half.
For the best in Big South coverage, visit BigSouthSports.com. Stay current with the latest news, results, stats, standings, and much more. Enjoy video features showcasing remarkable student athletes, or connect to school sites or social media outlets, all from one place. Remember, the source for all your conference information is BigSouthSports.com. Coming up at halftime, we'll take you around the Big South. We'll look at the scoreboard, players of the week. We've got a good Big South feature for you, talking about programs that have started from the ground up. Monmouth in 1993 featured a Kennesaw State team, which since making their way into league play has been among the best in the nation. Highlights and stats we'll throw in there for you as well. First and 10 from their own 21. Inside, the give goes to McKenzie, who gets grabbed by the freshman linebacker DeAndre Clifton.
They are high on DeAndre Clifton, this Monmouth coaching staff, 6'3", 220, from Upper Marlboro, Maryland. They really like him.
On 2nd and 7, Hampton will empty out the backfield for Francois. Gets the snap, throws, almost intercepted by Grimes, who had visions of the end zone.
Grimes is going to kick himself for that one. That one had touchdown written all over it. I thought it was an influence fake by Francois, where he's just going to look that way and try to hit something deep down the field or backside, but he looked that way for an extended period of time and threw it. And I thought Grimes figured the same way, like he's not going to throw that football, and nearly had himself a pick six.
Grimes, the Hawks' leading tackler, coming in. He had 18 last week in the win over Campbell. Was rewarded with the defensive player of the week within the Big South, and I would have to think he will be in the conversation perhaps for Defensive Player of the Year.
And he's played some outstanding football.
I was able to talk to him after the Campbell game last week, and you know, he's a guy that is listed as a senior, does have a year next year, and in his first couple of years here at Monmouth, beaten up by injuries. And you love those stories when you, it all kind of comes together. You stay on the field, you're healthy, and you're playing well. And he's just had a fantastic season on what's been a pretty good Monmouth defense all year long.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people outside of a program don't really understand what these kids go through and what they have to deal with. Sometimes they may look at a depth chart and look at stats and think, like, okay, this guy is not a factor. But dealing with injuries, dealing with adversity, and finally being healthy and being out there, you're seeing the best of the student athlete, and he's an exemplary example of that.
28-7 Monmouth, the third down and seven for Francois. Rolling right, throwing, has nothing, and puts it into lane three of the surrounding track. Pirates will be forced to punt.
And that's not what you wanted to have offensively if you're Hampton, because now you give the ball back to Monmouth, who has shown the ability to run the football and pick up chunk plays on the ground with 5 minutes and 35 seconds left in this half. So I'm pretty sure Monmouth, although they want to score, will try to drain this clock to make sure they have the ball last in this half.
Fourth and seven. Aroha with that soccer-style kick. Gets a good roll. And out of bounds around the 35-yard line. 24 teams in the FCS playoffs. Monmouth will be one of them. In a season, Emery, where there's the 12-game season, what's the magic number, you think, for teams to get in? Is it eight this year? Will you see a seven-win team, a team that maybe creeps in?
I think you'll see a seven-win team, but eight obviously is the number you want. Let's look at the OVC. Austin Peay has eight. You have UT Martin with seven. You also have a team in Jacksonville State flirting with seven as well.
Looking downfield for Moore, who makes a tremendous adjustment on the football.
That's just a great job by Lonnie Moore, who's usually their short area receiver. They take him right down the seam and go deep down the field. He made a nice adjustment to make sure he secured that catch. He's having a tremendous day out here catching the football.
Monmouth essentially looking to drive a nail into the coffin with maybe seven more. Bahar looking down the seam, has the big target, Sean Clark, but just overthrown.
I think that's an opportunity for Clark to make that reception. It would have been a tough throw. He had a lot of space to really haul that football in, but just a great job by Lonnie Moore adjusting and fielding that football the best way he could to get them down inside the 30-yard line. But going back to your point, you also look at Southeast Missouri State. So all those teams vying for an opportunity in that large bid. Seven is the magic number, but you kind of want to get eight this season.
Bahar looking, has his ball deflected and intercepted. Got knocked down at the line of scrimmage, grabbed in by Caleb Brown, and a scoring drive for Monmouth is stalled.
That's a great job defensively, being Johnny on the spot by Caleb Brown. This goes to show you how missed opportunities can hurt you offensively. Monmouth missed an opportunity to get a touchdown on the previous play. Now this was a great job by Sturdivant getting that hand up in there and batting the ball in the air, and Caleb Brown hauling in the interception.
Just the eighth interception on the season against Bahar. And Hampton will have an opportunity here to cut into this 21-point deficit. Some of those automatic bids still up for grabs today. Patriot League with Holy Cross leading the way at 4-1. A win today for the Crusaders. They lock it in, but at last check, they were scoreless with Georgetown. Here comes McKenzie, runs through a tackle. Keeps his feet into Monmouth territory. Around the Hawks 45-yard line.
a big-time run right there by McKenzie. Very impressive with his skill set. This is the guy that, you know, started at Virginia Tech, but you see the elements of a big-time back, big-body guy that has good footwork and find his way downfield.
Francois with four, now five into the pattern. Hangs in the pocket, throws, wants to go downtown. Almost taken back by Anthony Budd, who leads the team with five interceptions. He was pretty close to getting six.
If you're a high school football player and you want to understand what Division I range is like at the safety position, this is an example of that by Anthony Budd, just getting on his horse and getting over top that route and putting himself in position to make that play. That's just an excellent job by your safety, really shrinking space and nearly coming up with a turnover. You're going to see right there on the replay, just a great job getting on his horse. You see him get over there just in time. Had a great opportunity to pick that ball off.
Francois gives to McKenzie again, weaving through the Monmouth defense, and another big run from Shy McKenzie. Had 23 last time, a similar effort here, and Hampton knocking on the door for a potential score.
Same thing I said for Hampton and Monmouth on the other side of the field. Monmouth had an opportunity to make an interception. They didn't. Now you give up a big chunk play on the ground to Shy McKenzie.
That one 22 yards officially. So 45 yards on two carries in this drive for McKenzie. Francois wanting to throw, lofting it up, looking, has a man, and that is a touchdown. Kieran Catlett, the transfer from Purdue, has given Hampton some life on the far sideline.
That's an excellent job right there by Catlett, using his body as a shield to keep the ball and the defender away from each other, and was able to haul that in and get both feet in bounds. Would have been good on Sunday for a touchdown.
Credit Hampton for taking the interception and converting it into points. Extra point coming for Lomax. Bobbled snap, in trouble. Lomax not able to get it away. Hampton will have to settle for 28-13.
It's a great job downfield. Excellent display of receiving talent right there by Kieran Catlett, the junior, you said, former Purdue Boilermaker. So he's another one on this Hampton team that's kind of used to this weather. It doesn't really affect him out there on the field. But that's the type of play Hampton needed to get right back in this ball game. Only two-possession game. So we'll see if their defense can come out inspired and get another stop before halftime.
3:19 remaining. What seemingly would have been a scoring drive for Monmouth, the way that Kenji Bahar was taking his team back down the field again. Deflected ball at the line of scrimmage. And Hampton able to convert it into points off the interception from Caleb Brown. Keeping that FCS playoff conversation going, these are the bids that are still up for grabs today in terms of the AQs: the Big Sky, the Ohio Valley, and the Patriot League. End over end kick, returnable for Morales. I think called a fair catch. I'm not sure that he did or somebody did for Monmouth. It's always kind of it's become hard to gauge the fair catch on the kickoff, because it doesn't necessarily have to come from the player who catches the ball anymore. It can be anybody.
Exactly, and that throws you off as a returner, because you may see something that you want to exploit, but your teammate is just trying to protect the situation and protect the ball and calls fair catch. And you just kind of like, man, what are you doing? But I understand why, because you may have, especially on kicks like that, you may have someone that's not familiar with handling the football that you don't want trying to run with the ball, and perhaps a turnover would happen.
Guerrero and Bahar in the backfield for Monmouth. Hawks, two timeouts remaining. Guerrero coming left, runs into Brown and Sturdivant. Gain of a couple.
You're right, when you're watching Pete Guerrero run the football, you just
are waiting for him to pop out of that pile and accelerate downfield, because he's so dangerous. Once he gets that engine going, it's tough to get him down.
Bahar wanting to throw here. Parham, the catch at the 40. Gets Mom at the first down. Out close to the Hawk 45.
It's been interesting to see him come along late in the season and gives them yet another weapon as they go into the playoffs. So Parham, listed as a tight end, but plays more like a bigger wide receiver. This gives him another weapon in the passing game.
Plenty of time here for Bahar, who calmly gets back to the line of scrimmage. Looking right, throwing right. Green heading towards the sideline, gets spun out of bounds by Joseph Towns.
That's a heads-up play right there by Terrence Green, the receiver, realizing the situation and working himself back across the field to get out of bounds.
Clock continuing to move. Inside of two. Bahar, quick throw again. Parham, who's got another catch, his third on the day.
Third and one, they bring in Aiden Johnson. I'm sorry. They bring in Gene Scott, the other tight end. Almost like their H-back, an additional blocker. So it wouldn't surprise me to see a run here by Mama.
Scott setting the edge on the left side of the offensive line. It is Guerrero who gets his number called. Spinning out of danger, but going backwards in doing it. Monmouth will lose two on the play. They'll spot it at the Hampton 49, and it will bring up a fourth down and three.
I'm surprised Hampton didn't take a timeout here. If you're Monmouth, you're just content letting this clock just run before punting the football.
Conventional wisdom probably says punt it here, but it looks like it'll be at least a gamble to line up and go for it for Monmouth on fourth and three. Play action for Bahar. Rolling right. He is in trouble. He lets it go. Has a man to the far sideline. It is Gene Scott who makes the catch and gets Monmouth the first down.
That's just a great job by Coach Callahan, trusting his senior quarterback with the football in his hands in this crucial situation, getting outside the pocket and allowing himself to find his tight end, Gene Scott, that worked himself open to get the football.
Third catch of the year for Scott, who had a big one last week against Campbell in the first quarter. Inside of now a minute to go, and Monmouth has elected to use a timeout.
It's been all offense for Monmouth in this ballgame. 384 total yards so far in this half.
This is the top 10 teams that are hoping to have their names called tomorrow, maybe in the second part of the selection show, looking for those byes. North Dakota State, James Madison, the top two teams. Don't think there's any bit of an argument there. But you scroll down. Listen, to be fair, the one that to me is a little quizzical is Kennesaw State being at 9 after Monmouth handily beat them down at their home field.
Yeah, and you talk about Monmouth being ranked 12th, and some people had an issue with that, but they've beaten a top 10 team, and Kennesaw State dominated that ball game. So I think the Big South is a two-team bid this year coming from this conference.
Bahar wanting to throw again. Skips it in low to Lonnie Moore. That was the coaches' poll that we saw. The media poll has it reversed. They have Monmouth ahead of Kennesaw State by a spot or two. I would have thought, too, coaches would look first at head-to-head more so than even media. Like, oh, you beat this team, you must be better.
Especially when you look at the schedule. And I'm not the type to make, make it an issue of you only can beat who you're playing on the schedule. But when you look at the two non-D1 wins by Kennesaw State, it makes it tough to rank them ahead of Monmouth, especially when you factor in the head-to-head.
Second and 10 for Bahar. Ball at the Hampton 41. Bahar in trouble, lets it go, wisely got rid of it. Lot of pressure that time around coming in, and Hampton juiced up on that far sideline. Pressure from Keenan Marr, number 99, Jalen Williams, 95.
This defensive line for Hampton has started to find their rhythm as a pass rushing unit. You've seen a lot of pressure come from the interior. Now pressure starting to come from the outside. Keenan Marr, the senior from Atlanta, Georgia, Grady High School, find himself in the backfield disrupting that play.
Sets up now third and 10 with 45 seconds remaining. Don't be surprised to see Guerrero get a touch here, even on third and long. Bahar throwing, looking, Green climbing the ladder, making the catch inside the 20.
If you're not impressed with the way Kenji Bahar throws the football, then you don't know what you're watching. That was a great throw with velocity and placement that got them deep downfield.
Right to the line. It is Guerrero this time. Inside the 15, grabbed at the 13, gain there of about six. Bahar's number is so efficient today. 19 of 26. 294 yards. Yeah, we're still in the first half.
He's been playing some phenomenal football this season.
Regularly goes over 300 yards. Trying to add to his total here. Steps up and gets dropped. Monmouth will use a timeout. They're within range for a Matt Mascara field goal.
They wanted to take a shot toward the end zone. You're going to see the Terrence Green reception here on that previous play going down the field on a bang eight route. So they wanted to try to get a shot play in the end zone, but great coverage on the back end by Hampton. And Bahar did something that you didn't want him to do in that situation, take a sack. But good thing they had a timeout to burn, and now you're going to see that field goal unit go out there and try to get 3 points.
Matt Mascara, 10 of 14 on the season. His long is 47. He'll be right at that spot. A yard back. They're going to spot it at the 28. So this would be a season long of 48. Good snap. Good hold. It has the leg, and it is through. That would have made it from 60. 48-yard field goal for Matt Mascara to wind things down. 31-13. Monmouth will take a comfortable lead into the break. Hampton has kept it alive, but it's been a little too much of the Hawks. Come back. We start halftime right after this. Halftime here from West Long Branch, New Jersey. Monmouth leading Hampton by a score of 31-13. Take a look at the most current Big South standings as Monmouth trying to be the team who finishes not just at the top of the league, Emery, but at the top of the league with an undefeated mark.
Yeah, you look at the rest of this conference, man. You have Campbell, who has been very competitive. We've seen Charleston Southern pick it up late this season, and we're looking at this Hampton football team as not a bad team, and we know North Alabama can score. So I think this is a very good conference, top to bottom, one that we will see get two teams in the FCS playoffs.
And those two teams, Monmouth already qualifying as the representative with the automatic bid, Kennesaw playing host to Gardner-Webb. That game set to kick off in about 30 minutes or so. A win for the Owls at 10-2 with their pedigree and resume, you'd have to think would be enough to get them in as one of the at-larges. Let's take a look at the reigning players of the week. We've been watching some of them here today for this Mama team. On the offensive side, it was Pete Guerrero who led the way for the Hawks over Campbell last week, a co-offensive representative with Christian Lopez. But Guerrero, the great day, 237 yards with the four touchdowns. We're talking about Daquan Grimes. And again, the theme for Monmouth, it's been balance all year.
Yeah, balance is the key. When you have the ability to throw the football anywhere on the field with a guy like Kenji Bahar, you have the ability to run the football with Pete Guerrero and close out games with his ability to score, you're going to be very tough to beat. It's a big reason why they're 9-2.
And you mentioned Charleston Southern coming on as of late, Alex Ushery and Tavian Montgomery with representation there as well. We'll take a timeout. When we come back, we've got that feature, Big South Football Startup Programs for you. Monmouth leading 31-13. It's number 12, Monmouth leading Hampton in the regular season finale here from West Long Branch, New Jersey. Hawks trying to pick up their 10th victory of the season. The Czar. I love it. I love that nickname, by the way. The Czar of the Playbook, Emery Hunt. I'm Matt Harmon inside our booth here from Monmouth University. You know, I think what we saw in that first half was what we would have expected. Kenji Bahar, very efficient. Pete Guerrero, the big plays. That's been the recipe for Monmouth's success all year long.
I've been more surprised with their defense and how they've held up in this passing game. We saw Hampton go down the field, get the score in the passing game with Jadakiss Bonds, but defensively, they've held up. They shut it down. And they have a big-time lead right now at the half.
You know, for this Monmouth team, they are playing not just for a home game, but a potential seed in the upcoming FCS playoffs and the good balance all day. We mentioned Bahar. He's close to 300 yards. That's just a half worth of work, but a big advantage for Monmouth overall in the offensive categories.
Yeah, and you look at third down defense was key because that was an issue in the first drive of the game, which is why Hampton got down there and scored. But you look at what they're doing now, 2 out of 7 on third down, shutting them down defensively, and they haven't even crossed 100 yards on either running or throwing the football.
It is senior day here today for Monmouth, so they were honored before the game. Big plays all over the place. There's that touchdown to Bonds, and you got the sense that maybe Hampton was here to play, but after that, it was pretty much all Hawks.
All Hawks in all directions. You talk about Pete Guerrero having a receiving touchdown, a rushing touchdown, Bahar throwing the football accurately deep down the field, finding big-time playmakers in the passing game, getting the tight end involved as well. So it's been all Monmouth offensively outside of that first drive of the game.
Pete Guerrero, big offensive day. He's the reigning Big South Offensive Player of the Week. Quentin Parham getting involved. A lot of stars for this Monmouth offense. They lead it 31-13. We come back for the start of the third quarter right after this. We wrap up our Geico halftime show. Get you set for the start of the third quarter with Emery Hunt on Matt Harmon. We are looking forward to this one. The Hawks essentially, Emery, 30 minutes away from not just wrapping up the Big South Championship all by themselves, but they will have a big smile on their face getting ready for Selection Sunday tomorrow.
Yeah, and it should be a great way to celebrate the accomplishments they've done this season as far as playing great offense, great defense, find themselves in a position where they potentially could get a home game in the FCS playoffs, which will be huge for this program.
Hawks will get the football to start here in the third. Short returnable, but instead the fair catch is called for by Eddie Morales. So Monmouth football, they'll get it at the 25-yard line. Here's our quarterback comparison. We talked about both of them in the open. What a great start for DeAndre Francois, who took his Hampton team right down the field start of this game in the first quarter. But since that point, Emery, he has really struggled to find his targets.
Yeah, it's just been a lot of drops, and he's been under duress. He had to throw the football away about 4 or 5 times. So the numbers may be deceiving. I thought he played a little bit more conservative in the first half after that first drive, but kind of want to see him get back to that aggressive mentality of throwing the football deep down the field.
And in a way, you almost kind of wonder on a day where you're playing for pride, maybe you got a chance to finish 500, but essentially you are the team in Hampton with nothing to lose on a day like today.
Exactly. So you want to be extra aggressive in how you call your defense and how you throw the football and how you attack this defensive team of Monmouth. You have no more games to play, so you have to leave it all out there on the field. And you can't take any plays back into the 2020 season or into the 2020 season, so it'll be interesting to see how they call the second half.
7-yard run for Pete Guerrero to open things up. 2nd and 3 for Monmouth. Guerrero looking left, then going right. Gets 3.5. Kept his feet moving. They will blow it dead, however, which will lead to a quizzical look on the Mama sideline.
Yeah, he thought he wasn't. You thought he wasn't down, but just a great job. Maybe he wasn't, but the refs blew it dead anyway. Got to stay alert defensively.
Does give Monmouth the first down. Bahar with a first and 10. Guerrero in the backfield looking over the top. Green makes the catch, and he will stay in bounds.
That's another fantastic grab right there by Terrence Green, who's doing a great job of just tracking the football today. He had that defender draped all over him. You saw him once again use his body to shield the defender away from the football and kind of keep himself in bounds right there to haul it in over his shoulders.
Quite the day for both Moore and Green. That one, 26 yards. There goes Guerrero. See you later. Touchdown, Monmouth. I think he might have went untouched through the line and right in to pay dirt.
You can't get those type of runs in practice where they let you break free down the field. So been impressive all season long. And once again, I'm just going to make the case for him. If he is not a Peyton Award finalist, they're doing the award wrong.
You might have two guys from Monmouth make that list.
That's
between
true.
Guerrero and Bahar, both on the watch list as it sits right now. Mascara will come on for the extra point. Just as Hampton started the game with a touchdown, Monmouth starting the half with a score of their own. Certainly how you want to get things up and going if you are a fan of the team in blue. Guerrero punching it through, makes it 38-13.
P. Guerrero is just a phenomenal runner, man. You have a great combination of speed, balance, vision. Just outstanding display right here. And you're right, he goes right through the middle and no one touched him. This is the second time we've seen him break a run right between that A and B gap. You wonder where the Mike linebacker is for Hampton. He's been out of position. It's almost looking as if they are one man short on those two big long touchdown runs.
You know, that look that we just got on the replay, I think kind of shows Guerrero not the biggest guy. He's 5'10", so he can kind of hide behind those offensive linemen. And because he has that speed, that extra gear, and very shifty, it is really hard to kind of figure out where he's headed.
I'm glad you brought that up, because the common misconception when you have a speed guy like this, people say, hey, run him outside, get him out there on the perimeter, get him out in space. No, you want to run these shorter, fast guys right down the middle, because like you mentioned, it's tough to find them, and when you do, it's too late. They're up on you fast and quicker than you are able to anticipate, and it's off to the races.
I teed that one up for you,
I guess,
didn't I?
That was perfect.
Kickoff is returnable for Bell. Inside his 5-yard line, 20, 25, has a hold to the 30. Tackle made by Morales in space. Hampton will get it here at their own 33-yard line. And for the Pirates, who come into this one at 5-6, they are a full Big South member in not just football but all sports. But this really their first Big South year. Talking with some of the Pirate administration, they said, listen, it takes a little while to kind of get used to a brand new league. And you could tell, competitive loss at Gardner-Webb, the win over North Alabama, which is also making the transition, their official league win against Presbyterian, but they've been in a lot of games. Overtime loss to Charleston Southern, hung in for a half against Campbell. Just not sure that they have the consistency yet that they need.
That's all you really need if you're Hampton. You have talent.
Here goes McKenzie in space. 40, 35, 30, 25, 20. Has one man to beat and gets pushed out of bounds by Bud.
Speaking of talent, that's a tremendous talent right there in Shy McKenzie. And you see two guys in McKenzie and Guerrero, different speed level, but right here, just a great job. Untouched in the middle once again, and you saw him get to the outside. He's over 100 yards. He's having himself a very good day running the football.
Very good vision on display from Shy McKenzie, who gets his number called here again off the left side. Works down to about the 6, where it will be second down.
well-earned break right there by Shai McKenzie. Trot to the sideline, and he's running hard today. Been another bright spot for this Hampton offense.
That will bring Darren Butts in at the running back spot. Almost a must-score spot here for Hampton to have a chance in this game. Second and five. Receivers either direction. Tight end either direction. Francois wants to throw. Fade pattern, looking. Morales got a hand on it. The intended target was Bonds.
You got to give credit to the right side of that Hampton offensive line. Big number 74, the right guard, Michael Joseph, a redshirt sophomore from Memphis, University of Memphis, 6'4", 334. And number 77, Keldrick Wilson, the redshirt junior. We talked about him earlier, 6'6", 296. So anytime they've had success running the football, it's come to that right side. And that right guard, right tackle combination is having their way with that Monmouth defense.
McKenzie stays on the sideline. Francois, little option pitch. Butts in trouble, nowhere to go. Gets run and pushed out of bounds by DeJuan Cooper.
Great perimeter defense right there by Monmouth, beating him to the spot and trying to force him back into the inside where his help was, where their help was. Did a great job just corralling Butts right there on the outside. On a previous play, you saw the fade route to Jadakiss Bonds. You kind of want Bonds to be a little bit more aggressive in fighting for that football.
On for an attempted field goal is Evan Lomax, number 21. The punter, Aroha, the holder. And we've got a timeout taken just prior to the snap by Hampton.
First charge timeout, Hampton, 30 seconds.
Don't often see a team take a timeout just before their own player getting set to kick.
You would think it would have been a chance for them to maybe go for it, but they're going to go ahead on and kick it.
Monmouth leading here 38-13. Our out-of-town scoreboard involving the teams from the Big South brought to you by Sunbelt Rentals. We mentioned the games getting up and going. The 2 o'clock start just kicking off. Kennesaw home for Gardner-Webb. 3:30, Campbell will be at Charleston Southern. And Presbyterian, who is transferring out of Big South football into the Pioneer League, leading St. Andrews by a score of 21-0.
Shout out to the Blue Hose. You don't really blow out Presbyterian. They're a fundamentally sound football team, and it's going to be interesting to see how they compete out there in the Pioneer Football League.
This will be a 26-yard field goal attempt. Good snap, good hold. Kick drifting left and no good.
You don't want to say he iced his own kicker. But that timeout really hurt Hampton. Great drive, great run by Shai McKenzie. Had a nice chunk play on the ground. They got them in position to score. And unfortunately, you come up with no points if you're the Pirates. But these are the type of things that have gone on with them all season long. Again, inside the red zone, they're 30 of 51, 59%. That's not what you want to see from an offense with this many playmakers.
Monmouth offense back on here. In charge of this game, it is Guerrero again off the right side. 40, 45, 50. Tiptoeing the far sideline, stepping out of bounds. And oh, by the way, I'm sure we'll take another look at it. Notice his lead blocker. It was his quarterback, Kenji Bahar.
You saw Bahar not just get outside and lead him, but lead him all the way down the field. Just a great effort right there by your starting quarterback. He wants to get out there and see him get a big run as well. But good job by Guerrero just using his blockers. And Bahar just continuing to hustle down the field and getting a nice block right there on number 5. And Markel Valdez, the corner that was coming in chase.
One play and another big run for Pete Guerrero, who has cracked over the 200-yard mark today. 230 and running. Play action. Bahar wants it all. Looking for Green. Has a step on his man. Touchdown, Monmouth. The little play fake from Bahar froze the corner just enough. And Green into the end zone, 40 yards out.
Two-play drive for Monmouth on this series. The big run right there by Guerrero and the nice deep shot to Terrence Green, who's been outstanding today. First half, earlier parts of the first quarter and early parts of the second quarter, it was Lonnie Moore, and now it has become the Terrence Green show. But Bahar and Guerrero have been excellent throughout.
Sixth catch, 120 yards for Green. You've got Bahar 360, Guerrero 230, Moore over 100 yards and a touchdown. Green over 100 yards and a touchdown. It has been all Monmouth. Somebody get their hands on that chain. Emery wants it for the post game. Monmouth leading this one big.
Success in the classroom, the NCAA Division I FCS, every down, every day.
Two-play, 80-yard scoring drive, capped off by a Terrence Green touchdown reception from Kenji Bahar. It's been all Monmouth as the Hawks lead in this one by a score of 45-13. You know me, Matt Harmon. That's Emery Hunt. We introduced him earlier. Happy to have in the box here Monmouth University President Dr. Patrick Lay, who is good enough to give us some time here. 10th university president in school history. Well, you have to enjoy what you've seen so far here today.
Oh, I'm loving it. I was a little nervous at the end of that first half with the change of momentum, but I'm delighted to see what I'm seeing right now.
You know, for this Monmouth program, into the top 25, highest ranking in school history, already know that they're into the playoffs. It makes what's been such a great fall even better.
Even better, and I've been touting, Matt, that I'm so proud that we are the highest ranked private school in all of Division I football, FCS and FBS. That is a real source of pride for Monmouth University.
Here's the ensuing kickoff back the other way, out to the 27-yard line. And in a fall where you saw field hockey win a regular season championship, women's soccer go to the NCAA tournament, the excitement kind of around this football program will be capped off with finding out where they will be tomorrow with the selection show.
Tomorrow at noon, I think the show starts at 12:30. What a delight to know that we're in it, but then to find out where we're going to go or maybe where we'll host. Never know.
Where we will host, hopefully, would be right here.
And right
it would
here.
Be obviously the conversation. Maybe host, I think, with a win today, and if a couple of things go their way, could potentially get a bye for the opening round. You see Hampton here on offense. It's McKenzie off the right side. And when you think of it, I think this is an interesting question. When you've got a good, solid athletic program, which you kind of came into, but then it gets a boost like this year with football, what's it do just for the campus community, the students, the administration, the faculty, pretty much anybody who's involved with Monmouth?
First of all, three things, Matt. One is I love what college athletics means to the actual athletes, you know, the way in which these coaches are educators in their own right. So I love what it means for the athletes. Two, I love what it does for the community and the excitement it creates for our campus community. And three, really, it's a chance to shine a spotlight on our university, on our academic efforts here. So for all those reasons, I love what a successful college athletics program can mean to a university.
You think about it for you. I know during the course of this past week, you had a forum with some of the faculty here on campus as well, marking 100 days in office, which I thought was a real interesting way to kind of celebrate your first couple of months here. What have you been able to maybe think about in those first 100 days, those first couple months on the job from when you took over?
Yeah, the great confirmation for me is that now that I'm on the ground, I've been here, I've met a ton of people. This confirmed everything I thought about Monmouth University, and that is that we have something really special here. What we need to do is focus on how do we get more exposure for this university. And that's a challenge in a really competitive market, but it's something I think is going to really energize the entire community.
you talk about football being the front door of your program, of your university, and you saw this a lot with Doug Flutie in 84 in Boston College with the applications jump up.
Yeah.
What changes have you seen from that end because of the football team and how well they've been performing on the field?
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest. You get to play schools outside of New Jersey. I mean, right now, 75% of our students come from the Garden State, which we're really proud of, but we'd like to expand that reach a little bit. And one way to do that is to have our football team playing schools along the southeast corner of the U.S. and our field hockey teams playing super regionally and our women's soccer team. So hopefully it gets Monmouth University name out into secondary markets, Emory.
DeJuan Cooper, the interception. Monmouth will be able to stick around. All right, I've got a question for you. Have you been able to get your hands on that celebration chain?
I mean, I'm trying to figure out what a university president's got to do to get his hands on that. is that the turnover chain
big
play chain? Okay. I could have used that at that faculty forum on Wednesday.
Yeah, you could have put it on a couple of faculty. Okay, easier question this time. I'll let you wear the chain for a little bit. It has certainly been fun to watch this Monmouth program, and it's Pete Guerrero doing what he does again. I know a couple of weeks ago you had addressed the team after a win. When you have those one-on-one kind of interactions with the student athletes on campus, it must be special.
Oh, my gosh. It's why those of us who are university administrators love what we do. And I came by for a visit the Wednesday following the Kennesaw State game, and I wanted to come by to make sure that the players knew that even though they were down in Georgia doing that those of us back here on campus really appreciate how significant a win that was. And it's such a special time to be just with the players right here on Kessler Stadium at 8 o'clock in the morning on a weekday. It's really a special time for a university president.
Monmouth with Kenji Bahar pick it up 9. It'll be second down and 1. President Patrick Leahy joining us here in the box, the Monmouth University president. Hawks 45, Hampton 13. In your conversations maybe with Coach Callahan, with Dr. McNeil, the athletic director, what are the expectations that you have going into the selection show tomorrow?
I mean, I it would be great if we could crack the top 10 in a national ranking, and I would love to be able to, as you pointed out earlier, I mean, what a home run if we could earn the bye and host a game. I think, to me, it's more important maybe that we host a game. Maybe to the players more important that they earn that bye. But in either case, I mean, I think there's 24 teams.
24.
To be one of 24 teams. And there's a couple of schools ranked, or at least one school I know ranked ahead of us, whom we took care of on the field.
You mentioned that earlier
in
the broadcast.
I'm glad
today.
You did, because I'm looking at that and thinking, what's up with that? So, I hope we get this win today and we can celebrate being the outright champions of the Big South.
It's Guerrero off the left side, gets to the 40-yard line, gain of a yard. It'll be third down and 9. Have you made any inroads in couple of my fun conversations with you off air? I think you're dying to maybe call a couple of plays here or there. I mean, is there a chance that we could see you in the fourth quarter go down?
Maybe. I mean, let's be honest. I played football from the age of 7 to 18. I remember a little bit about it. Maybe not to do you guys justice, but I'll do whatever you need me to do, Matt. The university president here at Monmouth aims to serve, so whatever I can do to be helpful.
Versatile, right? I mean,
versatile.
It's all about versatility,
versatile.
Balance, maybe
right.
Showing that personality. As you look now, it's the transition from kind of the fall season into the winter. Basketball, a big win last night in the MAC Atlantic Sun Tournament. From where you came from at a school like Wilkes and now at a school like Monmouth at the Division I level, what's the difference that you see maybe from an athletic program standpoint?
Yeah, I mean, I always say even at the Division III level, I mean, the student athletes and the coaching staff and the athletic training staff, they're as committed as any level. But let's be honest, with the scholarship nature of the teams, with the national reach, with the ability to play teams from all over the country, it just takes it to a whole nother level. The facilities, of course, take it to a whole nother level. And it's a level I'm in which I'm very comfortable. So I'm hopeful that we can continue to support Monmouth Athletics and make sure that we're offering a great experience for the student athletes first and foremost, but also using it as an opportunity to gain additional notoriety for the school.
Were you looking to build this program down the line? Because I've seen, just from an outsider looking at how much it has grown over the last 5 years, there's some big steps that could happen down the way.
I mean, let's be honest, Emory, I'd like to do what we're doing this year, every year. You know, which I know is a lot of pressure on our coaching staff, but, you know, the spirit of that is, of course, we want to compete for conference championships every year. We want an opportunity to get into that playoff every year. And then, you know, you never know when you get into the playoffs, and you just never know what can happen. So I hope that's true of our football program. But that's really, I think, the goal of all of our athletics programs is let's give our student athletes the best possible experience we can. And let's be honest, that's probably pretty highly correlated with doing well on the field in order to give them that best possible experience.
45-13, Monmouth the lead. Had that change of possession. It's Hampton football here. Stick it around with President Patrick Leahy, who joins us here in the box. Monmouth getting set to host what should be a fun event tomorrow inside the Ocean First Bank Center, where the Hawks will be introduced as one of the 24 teams looking for a bye, in charge here to pick up likely their 10th victory of the season unless something changes. You know, I think as I listen to you talk about your interactions with people on campus, the student athletes, especially because of that age bracket for you, I know family extremely important, and it probably does help. You've got two kids in college. You've got two younger ones. So you kind of know, in a way, what everybody in this age bracket is going through.
I appreciate you saying that, Matt, because I think it's really important that the university president demonstrate to prospective families that I understand what they're going through. As you say, two kids all the way through the college search process, and now in college, two more are coming up. So I just want to make sure that our families of our students and our prospective families know that this administration appreciates what they're going through. And, you know, of course, we think Monmouth is a great option for their kids.
So you stopped your playing career at 18?
Yes.
Was there any hope that you could have been among those playing at the collegiate level?
I can tell you my one story, if I may.
That would be great.
I got one recruiting letter, one football recruiting letter from Brown University.
Okay.
They came to see someone on my team who really deserved it. I just happened to have a really good game. I was a tight end. And they contacted me and said, can you send us, you know, some of your stats? You know, what's your 40 time? What do you bench? What do you squat? So I sent them some numbers. Never heard from him again, Emory. I was not destined to play at the college level, I'm afraid.
Well, Emory, you could have helped. I mean, that's kind of right up your area, getting those recruiting kind of information pieces out.
I could have helped him out a little bit. We could have fudged some numbers and, you know, gave him the old two-inch cheat, 10-pound. We could have got you taller, bigger,
Well,
faster.
Here's the thing, too. So I do say I play a little college basketball because I studied abroad my junior year in the UK, because I was an English literature major, and I played on the University of St. Andrews basketball team.
Okay.
So I like to say I played a little college ball, and then when people ask me where I went to college, I tell them I went to Georgetown. If they want to put two and two together and think I played at Georgetown, that's their prerogative.
Were you really fudging the story a little bit? It will be a punt coming up here for Hampton. Monmouth will get the ball back, and we'll have a timeout. This has been great. I've always told you, you are more than welcome to come into this box anytime that you want to. Love hearing kind of the direction of what you think this university has to offer and will continue to offer under your leadership.
Thanks a lot, Matt. You guys do a great job up here. I mean that.
And, appreciate that.
So thrilled to have not only the action on the field, but such a first-class group of people calling the action.
President Patrick Leahy joining us here in the box. We take a timeout. We come back for more third quarter action. Hawks in charge of this one, 45-13. Marriott is the official hotel partner of the Big South Conference. For the best rates, book directly with Marriott by heading to BigSouthSports.com/Marriott, and you'll support Big South student-athletes in the process. That's BigSouthSports.com/Marriott. We certainly appreciate Monmouth University President Dr. Patrick Leahy coming by and giving us some time back here in the box with Emory Hunt. I'm Matt Harmon. It is Monmouth football. Hawks will take over after a Hampton punt just inside their five, and thought we would see this at some point. Monmouth starting to get a couple of substitutions into the game, including backup quarterback Brandon Harris. Probably a wise, wise decision. James Farah gets the carry. You've got Bahar and Guerrero both now on the sideline. And Emory, barring something out of the ordinary happening, I would imagine their day is done.
Yeah, I would imagine that as well. And I was starting to wonder, okay, the playoffs are on the cusp. When are you going to start to move some of these starters out of the game, with the game being as out of hand as it is? And, you know, you're moving the football up and down the field at will. Great job right there by Coach Callahan getting some guys reps, because you can't get these live reps in practice. You can't fake live action in practice. So game reps are critical, and he's able to get that opportunity here in his game against Hampton.
Farah on the ground. Big hole up the middle for James Farah, who gets a first down. The sophomore running back from nearby Point Pleasant, New Jersey, 6'1", 185, thrust into a bigger role this week with the injury to DeVell Jones.
A great run right there. They've had a lot of success running inside against this Hampton defense. As much as they've done a good job of applying pressure Hampton has on the interior against the run, this Monmouth offensive line has been doing a great job in just creating space.
Harris wanting to throw. Had Dre Tucker down the sideline. Play broken up by Christian Angulo. A couple of scores of note from around the country. Villanova leading Delaware 34-14. I would say the Wildcats will be among the teams who would be thinking of a potential first-round bye out of the CAA. James Madison, the conference champion there. And it's Albany leading Stony Brook by a score of 14-0. Great Danes, one would think, getting a win there, they would be an absolute lock, a team that Mama saw earlier in the season. Hawks getting a win. It does make this last day of the regular season just so intriguing, because there is such a small margin for are you in or are you out tomorrow.
And I've seen a lot of these teams play live. You look at Villanova, I was at that game against Colgate in the beginning and saw a dominating defensive performance. This is a sign of what was to come by this Wildcat program. They had a little bit of a lull in the middle part of the year with a two-game losing streak, but they're at 8 wins, and it sounds like they're going to be well on their way to 9. Are they going to be this season? So you're right. Not a lot of room for error for a lot of these teams on the bubble. But if you're Monmouth, you kind of want Albany to continue to win, because that helps your strength of schedule and helps push you up the rankings in hopes of getting that bye and also at home playoff game.
Little bit of a surprise, the Battle of the Wild in the state of Montana. Montana State leading Montana 10-0. That one still early in the first quarter. That could turn the entire Big Sky Conference upside down. Likely to get four teams in the upcoming playoffs. Farah, the little screen catch down the far sideline. Pushed finally out of bounds by Curtis Holmes.
I don't mind throwing the football here, and I'm glad coaches continue to throw the football. And I'm going to get on this soapbox for a minute, because you see a lot of folks talk about this quote-unquote running up the score. There's no such thing as running up the score. You have your backups at practice all week long, just as hard as your starters. You're going to put your backup quarterback in a game just to hand the ball off? No, you're going to allow him to throw the football and get those live reps. So I like what he's doing now.
Well, too, it's not as if he's – let's listen in. There was a penalty that was called.
Personal foul. They'll leave a blindside block. Defense, number 52. 15 yards added to the end of the run. Automatic first down.
Get an illegal blindside. Said block, I'd have to say hit would probably be the better way to describe it, on DeAndre Falk, the redshirt freshman linebacker. Just to continue the point, I mean, I think it's a valid one. It's not as if you're coming in with 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter. You've got a whole nother quarter to play. And in a lot of ways, Kenji Barr, who takes every single snap. If needed, you need Brandon Harris to feel comfortable throwing the football.
Exactly. You want to try to build that continuity, not only for this year, but you may need him next week and so on and so forth. So you want to have those guys have that experience.
We have reached the end of the third quarter. Monmouth with a 45-13 lead. We are back for the start of the fourth here in West Long Branch. Get social with the Big South. Join the always growing network of Big South fans on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and more. You can also follow the conference source for game updates and on-site championship coverage via Twitter at Big South Game Day. Follow, watch, like, and share with the Big South Conference. Inside the coaching box of the Hawks, that was offensive coordinator Jeff Gallo, who is working right now with his backup quarterback Brandon Harris into the game. We start the fourth quarter with this one in charge for this Monmouth team, up 45-13. Their dominant performance from this Monmouth offense, who came in averaging over 35 a game.
Offense, number 83, 5-yard penalty, first down.
This will cost Monmouth 5 yards. You know, Emery, when you look at Monmouth in league, 45 points against Presbyterian, 49 against Gardner-Webb, 35 against Charleston Southern, 45 against Kennesaw, North Alabama 49 points, 47 last week against Campbell. There's Harris with a long run, 45 today. They have had no issue within the league scoring points.
Yeah, and that's been a big reason why when you talk about them as a top 10 team, you have a lot of optimism, because they are a team that's explosive. They're playing their best ball down the stretch. They can score on anyone, and their defense has gotten better as the season rolls along.
Here's the zone read look for Brandon Harris, athletic quarterback for Monmouth, the junior out of the Bronx.
He's got some quicks, man. He's going to be the next in line to take over next year. Once Bahar graduates, but you like what you're seeing right now from him, getting some valuable game reps in his ball game.
Where is the time, even in a great season like this for Monmouth, that he's got a whole quarter really to work with? As Brandon Batts, the fifth-year senior, turning the edge, he'll get a couple.
And this is great teaching tape for Coach Callahan and these players that are getting valuable reps, because now you can show them against a different opponent. You know, normally these guys are getting these looks against each other in practice, but now you get a live look at how you adjust, how you react, and coaching points is going to help them be better as players overall.
Farrah in the backfield, three receivers to the left. He motions out, empty set, over the middle. Batts just has it go off his outstretched hand.
Batts was more worried about the referee there over the middle of the field than the football. He has to haul that in. That could have been potentially a touchdown and would have been one of memory for Brandon Harris, a junior, getting, again, quality minutes here in this ball game.
Holy Cross a quarter away from wrapping up the Patriot League automatic bid. They lead Georgetown 17-0.
Tough year for Georgetown. They've been on 5 wins for about 4 weeks and had an opportunity to get their first winning season since 2011 and just wasn't able to close the deal.
48-13, a field goal from Matt Mascara. Tacks on three more for the Hawks. Find the best variety of officially licensed merchandise, in-conference and school-branded items at BigSouthStore.com. Gear up with some new apparel or find that perfect gift. Fully equipped for all game day fun with BigSouthStore.com. Matt Harmon, Emery Hunt, 13-13 remaining. Hawks have been pretty good since that 2017 mark. Those two losses in 17 and 18 against the eventual league champion, Kennesaw State. The one, the only game that Monmouth has lost in program history since this stadium was redesigned a couple of years ago.
And those two losses were the talk of the town here during media day back in August. That's the team they focus on. They were able to overcome that bugaboo this season in a big way.
Coming out of the end zone is Bell. Just quite gets to the 20-yard line where it will be first and 10 for Hampton. We will see for the Pirates if they start to make any changes with personnel.
You want to see them get back to playing positive football. We hadn't seen that since the first drive of the game, and we saw a little bit of it in the second half with Shai McKenzie and how he'd been running the football. So you want to see them in on a positive note offensively to build on as they move forward with their program in the Big South.
DeAndre Francois did not have his helmet on. He will stay on the sideline. Austin Bradley, graduate student, former transfer in from Coastal Carolina, will get some reps and will call his own number. So we'd have to assume that Francois' day is done. A player like that, Emery, what's his future? What's his next step after finishing things up at Hampton here today?
But that's a great question because I think he has a pro future. Whether or not it's NFL, CFL, the new XFL, he definitely has pro-level game because when you look at what he did at Florida State in 2016, he kind of wanted to build on that and thought, okay, they have a guy that is the next in line after Jameis Winston moved on to the NFL. He had the injury in that Alabama game, kind of derailed what was supposed to be a huge season for the Seminoles. And then you saw the 2018 season or 17 season where he just didn't go his way. 2018 just didn't work out his way, and he found himself here at Hampton. But just out here today, you saw him throw the football really well. You saw him do great things in the passing game. So you see the traits, you see the athletic ability, and it's something to work with if you're a pro coach. You just want to see how healthy he's going to be moving forward and if he's a guy that still has some upside left in this game. But I do like what I'm seeing. I like what I saw from him throughout his career. I do think he's a pro-level player.
Third and three for Bradley. He throws to the sideline. A completed catch for Bonds. Bonds part of a wide receiver group. He's an underclassman, just a sophomore. Catlett a junior, so these will be some of the names that should be back for this team next year, this Hampton team, but they will certainly lose the talent in Francois, in McKenzie, in the backup quarterback now, in Bradley, so there will be some questions in the offseason for Robert Prunty.
Yeah, quarterback is going to be a huge issue. There are a lot of seniors at that position for the Pirates.
It's Bradley again off the zone read, getting to the sideline and stepping out of bounds. Picking up about eight.
But where they will have some success and something to build on is up front. Their offensive line, a lot of juniors. So you figure that will be the foundation for what they want to build on in 2020, which is a great foundation, by the way, because their offensive line, I thought, did really well, especially in the run game. So finding the quarterback, finding the new bell cow in the backfield will be topics of contention for this team moving forward.
Second and three. Run off the far side by number 43. That's Rashad Harriet. Run into and grab for the tackle, Solomon Manning, the former Rutgers transfer.
So you look at Shai McKenzie, 5'11", about 225, and after him, everyone is about at 5'8", 175 range, so they're going to go speedy, quicker backs next year. We'll see how that holds up, but they'll be running behind a very good and experienced offensive line.
Third and two. Play clock to five for Bradley. Looking off to his left. Now runs right. Moves from the pocket. In trouble. Comes back to the left. He has a little bit of space in front of him, but cannot turn up field as he has run ultimately out of bounds by the combination of Evan Powell and Russ Davidson.
Great job in pursuit right there by Monmouth's defense. It's getting initial pressure and not getting out of position, not getting out of their lane, their rush lanes, and was able to hold him to no gain essentially on that play.
Fourth and seven. Hampton will punt it away. Ivan Oroha, who's had a busy day, comes back in to give Monmouth the football back. Wobbly punt. Fair catch called for and made by Morales. Hawks football when we come back. Monmouth in charge. Well in line for win number 10 of the season. This Big South Network broadcast brought to you in part by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com today. And by Marriott, the official hotel partner of the Big South Conference. And also by Sunbelt Rentals, we have equipment for that. 8 minutes, 45 seconds remaining here in the fourth quarter. Monmouth in total charge of picking up win number 10 of the season, leading 48-13. Certainly they will be among those who not just will have their name called tomorrow with the FCS selection show, but you'd have to think today with another dominant performance, a home game at least, and depending on how some other games go today, and maybe at least in the conversation for a potential bye.
Yeah, we're talking about the top 10. You're talking about your North Dakota States, your Montana State, South Dakota State. You're talking about those teams. And Monmouth, to be honest, have been playing some great football down a stretch in an impressive way, which is always something that matters.
Throw to the outside. Caught by Sean Clark. And he gets wrapped up in the open field. Tackle made by DeAndre Falk.
Third down. Falk, the freshman, that redshirt freshman at 6'2", 213 from Lakeland High School in Suffolk, Virginia. Some great football down there in that area of the state of Virginia. Great high school football.
Third and one. 7.5 minutes and running in the fourth. Scott in motion. Farah gets the first down.
For a taller back, you see good body length right there by Farah. Now he's listed at 6'1", about 185. But he runs well behind his pads and, you know, is able to get that good body lean and good momentum pushing the pile. He's been impressive in his extended duty here in this ballgame.
Important reps for a guy which all of a sudden has become the backup to Pete Guerrero. He gets it on the zone read. It is Harris to keep it. Flag coming out. To finish the thought on Farah, you know, you went into this year thinking for Monmouth, you've got Pete Guerrero, you've got Juwan Fari, who was last year's rookie of the year in the Big South. You've got DeVell Jones, maybe the best three-way combination in all of FCS football. Fari out for the season. Jones at least out for this week with an injury. Romeo Holden, who was the fourth guy, he's injured as well. So you're James Farah, you're number five on the depth chart. Now all of a sudden you're going into the playoffs as the backup.
Yeah, you get the opportunity and you take advantage of it, because sometimes coaches will tell you, like, we like you, just keep playing, your opportunity will come. And you may not see it as the student athlete, but in this situation, here's his opportunity, and he's taking full advantage of it. And now to the point where you look at how he's running and what he can do catching the football out of the backfield, now you start to become a part of the game plan and not just a guy that's getting some reps. So he's put on a lot of good things on tape here in his ball game, and it just bodes well for his chances to play a lot in the playoffs.
They now trust you out there on the field.
Gain of a couple after a Monmouth penalty. There's Farron, number 29. We mentioned went to school Point Pleasant Borough High School. 20, 25 minutes south of here.
Monmouth does a great job of putting a little fence around this Jersey Shore area, getting a lot of homegrown talent.
Harris to roll and throw in space. That catch is made by Brandon Batts, who gets pushed out of bounds, and then 15 on top of it. Devonta Davis, the redshirt freshman corner, with the late shove out of bounds.
Frustration penalty. That's when you're allowing mental mistakes to become physical ones.
Personal foul. Unnecessary roughness. Defense. Number 24. 15-yard penalty. Add three in the run. First down.
Great start to the day for Hampton, but it went downhill after Monmouth was able to respond back. And tied at seven, and the Hawks never really looked back from there. Here's Sean O'Connor to get his first snap of the season, number 15, the third quarterback of the day we will see for Monmouth.
Sean O'Connor is 5'10", 190, junior from Spotswood, New Jersey.
Harris will come back in after one snap for O'Connor.
Second down and six. Mama doing a great job just draining the clock and getting the play, the right play in slowly, and doing a great job working on his time possession.
Harris to roll, throw, bats another catch, and gets pushed out of bounds. Second and six, got about five.
So Monmouth is still working their offense. They're still throwing the football. They are still doing a lot of the things that they're going to have to do next week, or maybe the week after, depending on how the seeding goes, to try to win and go far in the playoffs.
So we mentioned the Hawks a little bit thin at the running back spot. Farrell will now exit, and on will come freshman linebacker Isaiah Bishop, who was a fantastic two-way player down in Boyds, Maryland at Northwest High School. He has been taking some reps and will get a snap here on third and one. Unfortunately for Bishop, he'll lose a yard.
Gotta love when defenders are now on offense getting carries in. You know, he probably wants Coach to keep feeding them, but they're going to settle for perhaps a field goal here. Are you going to bring in
Kyle Butts, who is the backup keeper, number 40, will get a chance to put his name in the scorebook today. Obviously, everyone trying to get reps today. This will be a 40-yarder from the left hash mark. Good snap, good hold. The kick is up, and it is no good. Missed by much.
It's no good.
Butts is a senior. Team was ready to explode on the sideline if he would have made that field goal.
Hampton football when we come back. 3:05 remaining in the fourth. We've been talking about it all day long. The 24 teams selected for the FCS playoffs. You will see the representation here in the top 10. Some interesting scores as it sits right now. Number 6, Illinois State trailing at Youngstown State, 21-3. Kennesaw in a battle with Gardner-Webb, 7-7. Northern Illinois in a battle with Western Illinois by a score of 7-7 in the second quarter. All those games playing a major role. The selection show tomorrow aired on the ESPN family of networks. It will start at 12:30. Monmouth among the teams who have already qualified into the playoffs in 2019. Hawks' only other appearance back in 2017. They were beaten in the opening round by Northern Iowa. Big Sky yet to be determined the conference champion. The Ohio Valley still up for grabs in terms of the AQ. Patriot League, it's Holy Crosses to lose, and with 3 minutes to go up in Massachusetts, the Crusaders have a 24-0 lead on Georgetown. So a win there would put another team in.
Offense, number 64, 5-yard penalty.
The Montana State game said that would throw the Big Sky up for grabs. The Grizz would go to 6-2. Montana State would improve to 6-2. That would then leave opportunities for Weber State or Sacramento State to get the automatic bid. All of those teams will be talked about tomorrow for a potential at-large. Catch made by Bonds off on the far side. Lost his helmet. Other league still up for grabs was the Ohio Valley, where Austin Peay and Southeast Missouri State start the day at 6-1. Penalty on the play, flagged against Monmouth. A lot of new numbers in for both sides. Quarterback for Hampton is still Austin Bradley. Keeps it himself, gets dragged down, hit hard. First man on the scene was Solomon Manning. Then the freshman Tyler Delgado came in to clean it up.
Loss on the play.
Second and 13. And the Pirates taking their time getting the play in. They will let the play clock wind down. For this Monmouth team, with the win today, they will improve to 10-2. The last time the Hawks lost, week 4 at Montana, at that time they were 2-2. Do the math real quick. That's an 8-game winning streak tied for a program best that was also a championship year in 2003. Very interested to see how this Monmouth team is viewed by the FCS committee into the selection show tomorrow. An FBS loss in week 1 at Western Michigan. Throw that one out. So essentially you're going in 10-1. You've not just beaten, you have dominated every team in your conference. Closest margin of victory was an 11-point win over North Alabama, and that score deceiving as the Hawks gave up 14 late points with a lot of backup players in. Bradley to throw, airing it out deep down the sideline, underthrown and incomplete.
Pass intended for Bell was incomplete. Third down and 13.
Just over a minute to go. The opening round of the playoffs, by the way, is set for next Saturday over Thanksgiving weekend, November 30th. Inside carry going for Harriott. Hampton will finish up their year at 5-7, 1-5 in league play. I think certainly you could look at this Pirate team and realize the building blocks are there. And down on the field, there is a very welcome Gatorade bath on top of Monmouth head coach Kevin Callahan. Could have been done last week at Campbell, but I think a very deliberate Coach Cal stayed away from it, knowing that the opportunity here at home might be and feel even better. That's going to be the final play. Monmouth will finish up the regular season 10-2. They will be the undisputed champions in the league at 6-0. And they will head into Selection Sunday with an 8-game winning streak. They will find out their destination tomorrow. Take a look at some of the final numbers in this game in a 48-13 victory for the Hawks. Pete Guerrero, another big day, 240 yards. He is standing by on the field with Emory Hunt.
Pete, you crossed over 200 yards rushing today, crossing over 1,700 on the season. What was today like for you hitting those two milestones?
It seemed pretty easy out there because my O-line was doing such a great job, you know, especially when you have wide receivers that are taking time to block downfield. You know, when a whole offense is clicking like that, it's just good. It felt great.
Now you have something that a lot of people don't have, home run hitting speed. Once you see that second level clear, what is it about that opens your eyes to, hey, I can take it to the house?
I think it's just my track background. I think that since I ran track for a long time, I know that speed kills, and I know that that's what I bring to the table, and that's something that I'd like to pride myself on.
Congratulations. Go celebrate your teammates.
Thank you.
Pete Guerrero down on the field with Emory Hunt.
Thank you, man.
Emory standing by with head coach Kevin Callahan.
Coach, you finally were able to get that Big South championship, getting over that Kennesaw State hump with a big win today against Hampton. What was today like for you?
Well, today was all about finishing the job, and it started when we won our game down there, as you mentioned, and we just wanted our guys focus on finishing the job and winning the Big South championship outright, and I couldn't be prouder for these guys and happier for them.
Were you happy more for your offense or your defense, or just a total team effort after the day?
Well, when we play our best, it's when we have a total team effort like that, and you know, that's what we had talked to them about before today, coming in and putting it all together.
Congratulations, guys. Go celebrate with your team.
Thank you very much, Emory.
Emory Hunt, good job in an emotional scene down there for this Mama team. You see the celebration going on right now. Let's go back and look at some of the numbers in this game. Just amazing days for Monmouth offensively when you look at it. Kenji Bahar, 364 yards, 4 touchdowns. Pete Guerrero, 240, 3 overall scores. And then you've got Lonnie Moore over 100 yards on 8 catches. Terrence Green, 120 yards with 6 catches. They both had touchdown receptions, as did Guerrero, as did Quentin Parham, a Monmouth offense which has been clicking all year, certainly flying high into the playoffs. There is Monmouth University President Dr. Patrick Leahy, part of the post-game celebration as this Hawk team finishes up the regular season 10-2, 6-0 in the Big South. This one, a fun one for us to be part of. Senior day to start it off, a Monmouth victory to finish it off. For Emery Hunt and our entire crew, I'm Matt Harmon. We say so long from West Long Branch, New Jersey. The final score, Monmouth 48, Hampton 13. All games airing on the ESPN networks or streaming live, archived on the ESPN app. Don't forget, Selection Sunday tomorrow, you can watch it on the ESPN Family and Network starting at 12:30. You'll find out where all 24 teams are headed into the FCS playoffs. Monmouth wraps up the year 10-2. They are Big South champions. They are going to the playoffs. This has been a presentation of ESPN. Enjoy your football Saturday.